Hello and welcome back. Episode 11, I think this is, off the top of my head. Might be wrong. So we left off last time with our Wi-Fi working and querying NTP servers to get the real-world time at runtime, which is quite neat and a nice sort of simple way of proving our Wi-Fi classes is working, and the underlying Wi-Fi drivers, so on and so forth, all connecting to the internet. So we're in a good place. We want, however, to be able to send our Wi-Fi credentials, so the SSID and password, in a slightly more intuitive way. At the moment, we've got it hard coded in here. So if you're playing along at home, in Wi-Fi.h, change this to your SSID and your password. I'll just reiterate, this is the one I'm using in real life, but it's on a router that sat on my desk, that's bridged to my main one, providing its own thing, and I only turn it on when I'm doing the test. So good luck anyone who's trying to come along and connect, because you won't. But anyway, joking aside, we want to be able to send that. So the way the ESP IDF provides is, or one of the ways, is using the smartconfig protocol, which uses a phone app that ESP provide, and it works pretty well, actually. It's quite good. The way it does it under the hood is interesting. We're not going to dive into the management protocol frames and stuff that it uses. It's worth noting it won't work with every single router. I've got my main router is an ASUS router. I had to put the 2.5 gig band into legacy mode to get it to work, and as soon as I did that, it worked fine. Whereas the one I've got here for testing is on a Linksys router, and I think I've got it's either DDWRT or OpenWRT. I can't remember which one I put on it, but that just works straight out of the box. So that interestingly, that's not documented anywhere. I did flag that in a GitHub issue to Espressif, and there was a bit of back and forth on there. I'm sure you can probably find it, but that certainly solved my issue. We never really got to the bottom of what caused the issue, but we know what fixed it. So yeah, the question then needs to be asked. Okay, so we've turned powered up our ESP. It's sat there waiting for the smart config to kick in, because at this time, these are blank strings, for example, no hard-coded strings in there. So we do the smart config with our phone. It populates these two variables, which no longer will be constexpr, because we'll be changing them. But then the ESP reboots. Either we've done an OTA, it's thrown an exception, we have a power cut, whatever it may be. And we then have to do the whole process again with our phone. That's no good. We want to be able to save these credentials. And the way we obviously do that on a computer is you just save it to a file or a memory stick or something like that. The ESP doesn't have that, but we do have access to some of the flash memory, which is non-volatile, so it persists on a reboot or power off state. So it's not RAM, which needs power to remain alive. So we need to implement some sort of non-volatile access so we can write and read to this flash memory. So when we get our SSID and password, we can write it to the memory, and then if we reboot, the first thing we do is read that memory, see if there is a valid SSID and password, and then we can roll with that. and later down the line do some error handling, make sure that SSID exists, we've not moved, and so on. But we'll worry about that later. But in order to do this, we need to do some non-volatile stuff. We could just do it in-house in the Wi-Fi class, but chances are other functionality we're going to want on this project will also need some non-volatile memory. And then we've got two different classes, two different threads that could be running two different cores, so on, like we know, trying to access the non-volatile memory, and it could get quite messy. So it makes sense to have this as an object in its own right, as a module or component, should I say. So that's what we're going to do. Now, I have some notes to the side of me on my other screen, because I have already implemented this on something else, and it works quite nicely. So we'll do some of that. Now, we'll start a new folder. I'm going to call it NVS32, simply because NVS on its own is already used in the IDF, so we'll get folder confusion and the like. We'll copy over a CMake list, paste, and we'll fill this out. Tell you what, we can probably fill most of this out now, actually. It's light. Did I implement this as a header only? No, I didn't. It has a source. Okay. So our source file will be nvs32.cpp. Oop, CPP. And actually, the only thing it probably needs from the IDF is nvs flash for now. We can always come back and add if we need to. So that's CMake largely happy. I'm going to get rid of all this stuff we don't need. We'll leave main in there. And we'll create a new file. So nvs32.h. And let me just pull up my notes. Here we go. Okay. Now, we need to talk about this. So the way you define the memory that you're going to use, you have to create a partition, effectively. So it's a reserved chunk of memory in the flash that you're going to use for your non-volatile. So it's not your program code, it's not your Wi-Fi sort of configs that the driver uses. I'm trying to think of what else uses the non-volatile. But it's a separate chunk of memory that basically we're going to access sort of like a memory stick that we can read and write to at runtime. So let me just quickly pull up my notes on the other screen. Wi-Fi smart config is the one we'd like. Core partition table. Here we go. Lovely. So at the moment, we don't actually have any partition table defined. So in the menu config, which we'll pull up now, we'll be using the whatever the default is, which may well work, but we probably want a bit more finer control because we want to define how big this non-volatile memory is and so on. So we'll just wait for that to load, and I'll show you where it is in the menu config, and then we'll create our partition table. Any time today would be nice. Well, while it's doing that, we'll actually create the file that's going to hold it. So this will be in core, just because I think it fits there quite nicely. And partition, table. And it's required to be in a CSV file format. Yeah, there we go. So it's sitting under core at the moment. Now we can use the hash symbol to define a comment. So I'm just going to copy that in from my notes. So this is purely a comment in the CSV file. Don't know why this is taking so long. Anyway, we're going to have different partitions. First of all, we need the partition where our program is going to be stored. And this is our program that we flash to the device over USB or JTAG or whatever, different to an OTA partition. We'll come to that eventually. Now, these have particular names. So this is going to be our factory partition. So this is where our code lives that we flashed at the factory, effectively. So a factory being my desk. It's an app partition, and that's important that it has that name. This is all documented on the IDF webpage, you know. The subtype is factory. Again, that's a key word. It has to be that. You can store it wherever you like, but then you have to do a bit of config in the menu config, if this ever loads, to tell it what the entry point is. So that's the memory address that our program will start executing from. I'm going to use, so we'll do it in hex, and we'll do 10,000 hex, whatever that converts to in decimal, that doesn't really matter. It does have to be aligned though to a word boundary, where words on the ESP are 32-bit. So yeah, it's quite nice doing it in hex. We'll allocate 2M, so that's 2 megabytes for this. And we don't actually need any flags. So that is already done in the background for you if you're using the default one. But if you're setting your own partition table, you need this in there. Now, because we're using Wi-Fi itself, the actual driver needs some non-volatile, and this is where it sort of stores configuration for the transmit and receive powers, so amplifier, all the background stuff that the Wi-Fi driver needs to work. It's a data partition, so rather than app, it's data. It's non-volatile, so it has the NVS subtype. The offset, I'm just going to put a comma, which basically means put it at the next available memory address. So it'll be 2 megabytes after this one, because it's the next one in the list. I could work that out. I can't be bothered. It's just easier doing that for this. It would be nice to fill it out, but yeah, I can't remember what it is off the top of my head. And the size is defined in the IDF as 1000 in hex. That's how much the Wi-Fi driver needs. Easy as that. Another partition that the IDF requires is the physical initialization stuff. Again, this contains information with respect to the physical initialization of the device. Amplifier gains and so on, I think, live in here. I'm not too sure, but you need it. It's a data partition. And the subtype for this is PHY, for physical. We're going to stick it at offset 370,000. And according to the IDF, this requires 2,000 hex bytes. The offset, I could just leave this as a comma, so it'll stick it after the Wi-Fi partition. That would be perfectly fine. I can't remember what my reasoning for this is. Oh, yeah, no, I remember. So, yeah, we'll come back to why I've chosen 370,000 hex for where that lives. And then we come on to the topic of the day. So we're going to have an NVS partition. It's a data partition. Its subtype is NVS. And this is going to live at 390,000 hex, which you can see is... Is that obvious? No, not really. Anyway, and we're going to say this requires 5,000 hex bytes, whatever that is in. How many bytes is that? So if you pull up Windows Calculator, put it in programming mode, go to hex. What did we say it was? 5,000. 5,000 hex is 20,000 and a bit bytes. So 20k. And then the last thing we need is a place for the keys to be stored. And we'll talk about this later as to what the keys are, what this means. But it has the subtype NVS keys. And we're going to stick it at 300,000. And this will require... Well, I've decided this will require 2,000 hex bytes, which is, again, back to the calculator, 2,000, which is 8k. Oh yeah, of course it is. So that's our partition table. Save. Now, at the moment, that's not actually going to do anything because we've not configured the menu config to use this file. We'll see if it loads second time around. That looks more promising. Will it work? Well, while it's thinking about it, we'll... actually get on with some of the code. So the way I've implemented this is quite interesting. It's heavily templated for reasons that will become apparent. So if you're not hugely familiar with templates, this might be a good place to start for a bit of learning. So let's dive straight into it. So this is the header, so we'll do a pragma once. If you prefer define guards, then that is fine, use that. I prefer pragma once. Each have their merits and downfalls. Loads on Stack Overflow if you're interested in whether you should use pragma once or if and def NVS 32. Oops, that should probably have an H in it. And then you would do define, oops, and then an endif. So that's the sort of older way of doing it. Perfectly valid. Both sort of achieve the same thing-ish. Pragma once is slightly different. As I say, key into Google if you're interested. We're going to need some headers from the IDF, so we're going to need NVS flash, rather obviously, and we're going to need NVS.h from the IDF as well. So this is why we couldn't just call it NVS.h, because that already exists in the IDF. We'll do this in a namespace. Like that, and oops, and personal preference, but on the closing brackets of a namespace, I always like doing that because this is going to end up being at the bottom of the file, and you'll be like, why on earth is there a closing bracket? This just tells you straight away why. And we will define our class, and we can call it NVS, don't forget your semicolon at the end. And let's follow a similar structure to what we did in Wi-Fi. So we're going to need a logging tag because no doubt we'll want some sort of debug for this. And we'll do log tag. 0 pointers actually, you don't need to put that in because default initialization will be zero, which is equivalent to null pointer. I suppose let's put it in. So that's a redundant, but it's good for clarity. We are, okay, yeah, cool. So this won't be a static log tag because the way I want to do this is have, so for example, Wi-Fi can have an instance of this class, and that'll be different from our GPIOs having an instance of this class. Bad example, but hopefully you understand what I mean. So therefore, each instance will be different and be used by a different underlying module. So they'll have a slightly different log tag. That's why I've chosen to do it that way. Okay, so let's come on to the interface. Oh dear. So start off with the constructor. Now this is going to take our partition name. Which will be default to MVS. Later down the line, we may want to have additional partitions. So that's MVS, that's what it's called. So we're accessing this partition, but we may want to have some additional specific ones. Let's have an example. Well, let's say one for smart config specifically, and it only has data for smart config in it, and this will be some other address 40. I don't think that's valid, but we may want to give it a different name to separate things out into their own partitions. But by default, we'll use the default chunk of data we've assigned NVS to. And because we've already got a const parameter in this class, we need to initialize that. So our log tag, we use brace initialization, will be the partition name, like that. So hopefully what you can see here is each time we create an instance of this class, the log tag will be the partition that we are accessing. So if we're storing all our GPIO stuff, all our Wi-Fi stuff and everything in the default partition, then yes, they'll have the same log tag. And that sort of makes sense because we're accessing the same partition. Now, interestingly, at the moment, this can actually be a const expert constructor because we're not doing anything that's too funky here. And it doesn't need to do anything like that. We may need to come back and amend this and remove the const expert, but if it can be, it's a good idea for it to be. We will need a destructor, but we'll come on to that when we get there. We're going to need some sort of initialization. Let's define let's define the interface first. So since we seem to have got in the habit of using all this flavor text that you can do, let's use it. So we're going to need an ESP error type, and this will be our init method. And it's not going to take any parameters. It's no discard because if init fails to initialize, the user really needs to know that. So we'll tell them that you have to test for this. So checking for ESP OK is sufficient. And is that good enough? We've used ESP error type here, so we are going to need to include the header that has that, which is ESP error or error.h. There we go. Lovely. And we'll come back and fill in this functionality later, but let's try and do this top down. We're going to want some sort of getter to get the data within the partition. No discard, obviously, because why would you want to get data and then not use it? So this will be get. And we'll do getters and setters for this. We need to know the key. So if you're familiar with Python, this will make sense. The way that the non-volatile is done, or at least the way we're going to do it here using the NVS API, is data is saved as key value pairs. So if you're familiar with Python, this is effectively a dictionary. So you can look up a key and it will return the value. And keys are ASCII strings, so they are word names. That has huge disadvantages, obviously, because you've got to do string compares and so on. But anyway, that's what the API does. So we'll do it that way, the easy way. When it's up and working, if we think, actually, resources are a problem, we should probably do this in binary, then we can come back and improve on it. But let's get something working first. This is going to have to return an error type, which is a bit odd, but we need to know whether getting the memory was successful. And the typical way you do that is either returning an error type or returning a bool, true for success, false for not. But the way we tend to do things on the ESP is using the error type. It's got a little bit more info than a bool, and we can use the logging ESP error to name function, so we can actually get some good debug out of it. So we'll do that. We need to know what the key is. So it'll be a const pointer to some const data. So const pointer to const chars. I hate this notation, but anyway. And this will be our key. And then we will have a parameter that will be our return, where we will write the data that we've got from the MVS into the whatever the user provided us. What type is this going to be? Let's call it output, because this will be an output parameter, which means we're going to have to pass it by reference. You could do a pointer, but let's use references. They're a little bit safer for this. But what's the type? Well, if we stored a string in there, a C string, then this type will be a const char star. But what if we stored an integer? Well, this would be an int, or an int reference. But what if it was a bool? See where I'm going with this? What if this was a struct of some, you know, some definition, some type? Well, we're going to have to implement one, a function for each of these. Okay, so let's do it that way. So if you're wanting to get an int, if you're wanting to get a const char star, and we'll pass the pointer in by reference, That's probably not the way you want to do it, but anyway. What if it was a uint 8 by reference? What if it was you can see what's starting to happen here, can't you? What if it was a signed int 16? Right, this is getting stupid now, clearly, and hopefully I've proven my point. So there's an easy way of doing this, and this is by using a template. So that is what we will do. So let me just write that in. So we're going to use a template. We're going to define the type as T, and because T sort of doesn't really make sense to the compiler, we give it the declaration that what T is it's a type name. And so the compiler goes, ah, okay, right, I see what you mean here. You're going to use this as a type name. So that means we can then do that. So this get function takes a const char star, const key, and it takes some sort of variable of type T, which we're going to pass in by reference. So what that does is if we call, so say in our user code, not in our class, but let's just write it here, we do if ESP OK equals equals RNVS class, let's say we called it NVS.get, and we want to get our SSID, and we want to pass it to our SSID. And actually, what we can do is let's invert the logic there, then we can do some error happened getting it, else all okay. And then our SSID is going to be a character, let's call it a character array, which I can't remember how long it's supposed to be. There we go. So this is some sort of code that's in our user application. So we just define an array of chars, and then we call our getter. We want to get the SSID key, whatever is stored in non-volatile memory, using that key. And then we are passing in this SSID. Then we look up to come to the class, goes, ah, this is a template. What is the type T? Well, in this case, it is a char array. So T effectively gets replaced by char array. Yeah, I'm not sure where the reference goes. In fact, I'm not even sure that that's syntactically correct. It probably will go in as a char star. Okay, so then we have another implementation. So let's just reset this to what it should be. We have another implementation, which is a, let's say, a reset handler. So we want to get the number of times the ESP is rebooted for, this is a bad example, but anyway, it's going to be, let's just say it's an int n reboots, and then we can do the same sort of thing, and let's say and reboots is the key, like that. So this is in a different module, for example. This is in red because I'm doing it within a class, so this isn't valid code in this place, but this would be in an implementation. So what do? We define an integer, default initialize it, so that will be 0, and then we call our getter. So the compiler will look at this and go, ah, you're calling this function, which is a template. What is type T? Well, it's the type of what we passed in, which is an int. So we replace t by int, and that is what the compiler will do. But because we've also got this somewhere else in our code, what effectively happens under the hood in the compiler is the template vanishes, and this is actually not const, not spelt like that, is the compiler will generate two different functions, or methods in this case, with two different signatures, one for an int because we've called it with an int, and one for a char star because we've called it with a char star, which is what an array devolves into effectively. That might not strictly be true, but this works, it's perfectly valid code. And then say somewhere else we call this with a structure of type whatever it is, then the compiler will see that, and at compile time it will generate another function which is our struct type whatever it is. So it does all this copying and pasting, which we know is bad, but the reason it's bad is because, well, there's multiple reasons, is that you then have a load of code that you need to maintain, and if you change one you need to remember to change all of them if you find a bug, for example, and then it becomes messy, you've got loads and loads of lines. But the beauty of doing it as a template type name t is that we only need to define this function or this method once, but we define it in terms of type t. So there's only one method implementation in our code that we're writing, and then the compiler does the hard work of copying and pasting in the types and so on. So we only have one function to maintain. We still get copy and pasted code, in terms of what is compiled, but the optimizer will do a good job, and there's probably no other way of getting around this. The only way we could get around this is to not use that and do something I absolutely despise, which is pass in a void star, and in which case we would also need a length to be passed in, and we would then just copy that length of data. This is dangerous. It works, it's perfectly fine. If you're careful, you can do it, it's not a problem. There are cases where you do have to use void stars, particularly in embedded stuff, but every opportunity you have to avoid it would be my recommendation. So we have the opportunity to avoid it and do a template. Has its downsides, means we're going to get more code than if we did a void star, but it's less likely to have bugs. And really, is this function going to be a huge amount of code? Probably not. So each have their own merits. So doing it this way means we only need to define it once. Now, do we now show you what this implementation looks like, or do we carry on defining the interface? No, let's carry on defining the interface. So we can now get a key from memory. The next logical thing is we probably want to be able to set a value, so save to the non-volatile. And you guessed it, this is going to be a template. The general convention is when you're doing templates and you have a type name, you call it T. You can call it whatever you want. It doesn't matter. But you can call it whatever you want, as long as that word that you're keying in isn't used for something else. It's going to be no discard. Tell you what, it's going to be exactly the same as this. More or less. The only difference is we don't need to pass it in by reference, but we can pass it in as a const, because we're not going to be changing the thing that we pass in, and this is now going to be the input. So we'll call set, we'll say which key we're going to set, and then we'll pass in the variable that we want to save at that key in the non-volatile. Excuse me. Seems fairly logical. Now, another thing we're going to require, and anyone who's done non-volatile stuff will already know this, but we also need a way of verifying that what we have just set in memory, or what is already set in memory on a reboot, is what we think it is, what it should be, i.e. what we're currently holding in our RAM, so our volatile memory. So we're going to need to verify, and we'll talk a bit more in depth about this when we come to implement it and why we need it. So type name T again, you guessed it, and it's going to pretty much be exactly the same. So we'll call it verify. So we're going to pass in the key. So we want to verify the data that is saved in our non-volatile of this key. And we're going to pass it an input. And what this will return is ESPOK if the thing saved in non-volatile at this key matches whatever this input is. So the input, because you're calling it a runtime, will be saved in RAM or in a register maybe. And what we're doing is we're saying, right, go and look in the non-volatile and check if what we saved in there is not this. Is this. And if it's not this, then we might then want to call the set method, for example. Now, there's, how do I want to explain this? There's probably some template specializations we're going to need here. I would prefer avoiding doing template specializations. I don't mind them, but I feel like they can get a bit clunky. If you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry about it. Or if you want to learn, CPP reference, great place to start for templates and template specializations. But let's not worry about that for now. Let's probably stick in some comments though. So with respect to a type, it's probably a bad way of explaining it, but what if we want to get a buffer, so a chunk of memory? So we used the example on this one, getting a const char star. Now, those of you who are observant will know that that wouldn't work in principle, because getting a const char star, because it is a star, i.e. a pointer, it is just one word in memory. It is 4 bytes. So if our SSID was 33 bytes long, we'd have only got the size of that type of const char star, so we'd have only got 4 bytes of it, and then we start having issues with, well, this is a pointer, so the bytes we got don't make sense because they're not an address, they're a character. So well done if you spotted that. So we need a different method to say, now I want you to get a chunk of memory which I'm going to save to an address, and then that chunk will be a const char star, sorry, will be a const char, and we'll have a pointer to it, which is a const char star pointer, as we see up here. Not explained that particularly well. Let's give an example. Okay, let's explain this properly. What we're defining here is a variable called partition name. Well, it's a const called partition name. The type of this is a const char star, which is const itself. So it's a pointer. So what this is in RAM is just a memory address, typically in hex, and whatever address that is. What is stored at that address is 4 bytes. First one is the character N, next one V, next one S, and then the next one will be the null terminator, so 0/0 if you prefer. So, like that. But what this actually is just a memory address. So if we pass a memory address in, the type is just going to be a memory address, and all of a sudden things get confusing. But if this was saved in non-volatile, I want to say, no. I want you to get a chunk of data. I want you to get 4 bytes from there. Bad example, because 4 bytes is the size of the mem a pointer on this system. Right, let's do it before I make a fool out of trying to explain this. So with respect to a buffer, and we're basically going to have these same three functions. So we can do a bit of copy and paste here just to save me typing. But it's going to be to get a buffer. So let's just change the names of these first of all, and then think about what we're actually passing in. So to get a buffer, we're going to pass in a type that must be a pointer, or that we will make a pointer. So if we're passing in a char, then type T is char, and then we will convert that into a char star. That might look odd. This will make sense a bit later why I've done it this way. But then we also need to pass in a length. So we'll pass in a length. And for some very peculiar reason, I pass this in by reference in my notes, which is stupid because why would you do that? Yeah, that makes no sense. So const size t length. And we need that for the other three as well. Okay. Everything else can stay the same. We can still have it templated because this buffer might be chars, it might be a buffer of ints or whatever. So that's quite a nice interface already here. And probably that's going to do everything we want, unless we want to do a D in it. But more often than not, we're not going to want that. Okay. Right, yeah, okay, cool. So, what's our init going to do? Well, let's keep it sort of reasonably consistent with what we did in Wi-Fi. This is going to return some sort of static method, and we'll call it open partition. And we are going to pass it the NVS tag, our partition name, sorry. So we're going to pass it partition name. Which currently we are not storing. Well, we are storing as log tag, but that would be bad form to do that. So what we'll do is we'll say partition name. And this may become redundant. This doesn't necessarily have to be private now. So we will do log tag, and then we will do partition name. And you can do, and that's perfectly valid if I put a comma in there. The compiler works out the fact that, oh, you're trying to set the thing in your class called partition name, and what you're setting it with, oh, the thing you've passed in as partition name. So although they're called the same thing, the compiler's clever enough to work out what you're trying to do there and won't try and just override that with itself, which would be odd. Now, with my knowledge of the API that we're going to be using from Espressif, we also need a handle, or more correctly, what the API will give us when we initialize it is a handle. So we need to put that in, and that is of type NVS handle type, and we'll just call it handle, and we'll default initialize that. Jolly good. So our call to this static function, which we've yet to define, we will also need to pass in the handle. Like that. Is that correct? Yes, it is. Yeah. And this is an output. So what the API will do is it will open that partition named NVS, unless we told it otherwise, and then it will provide us a handle. So it will write to this handle. So this handle then becomes valid. Okay. So let's actually define the static methods. Protected, probably should be private, but anyway. First of all, let's actually define this open method. Again, it makes sense for this to be no discard, because we want to know if the API reported that it failed to open. So we called it open, and this is static. And it's taking a const char star, which is our partition name. Partition name, and then it's going to take a NVS handle type as a reference. Now that's important because we're going to be setting this, so we need to pass it in by reference, so the thing that gets passed in is changed. If you didn't do that, it would pass it in by copy. So it would create a copy of our handle, which at the moment is just going to be a null pointer. It would change that copy and then return. So it never actually changes the underlying thing. So we need to pass this in by reference here. And that's our handle. And this is quite simple because this is now an API call. So we can just return NVS open. And the API says we need to pass in the partition name as the first parameter. And a pointer to the handle. So this is going to look a bit confusing. So we're passing the handle in by reference, and then we're getting a pointer to where that handle is stored. And that is what NVS open requires. So that looks weird because one's a reference and one's taking the address of. But anyway, that's what it is. If you're not familiar with the ampersand and pointers and so on, I strongly suggest looking it up. on CPP reference or whatever of choice, and do some reading up on that because they are hugely important. Okay, so we can now open this partition, and we've got all the way down to the level of the actual API call. So if we hover over here, so the API actually takes the partition name, a mode, and then a pointer to the handle that's an output. So actually, we've missed a parameter in here. The different modes you can open it in, well, let's put the mode we're going to open it in pretty much every time, which is going to be read write. You can also open in read only mode. There could be value in implementing that, but to be honest, most of the time for everything we do, it's going to be read write. So let's leave it as that, and later down the line, if we want to do some sort of read-only implementation of this, we could, but chances are we're probably not going to bother. Okay, so we've got down to the level of the API call for init, effectively. Sorry, this is open partition. You know what? Let's just call it open. So going off the end of the page here. We also need a getter. So we need, that's the next thing on the list, is the API call that does this that we're asking it for. And this is where we're going to get quite clever because we now need to think about this template. The API won't take a template. It's C++ and the APIs are written in C. So we need to do some sort of template unwinding. I'm not sure if that's the right word. So let's think about that. This is going to have to be a templated function. Type name T. And again, it's going to be a no discard. You know what? I'm just going to copy and paste this. It's going to be static, so common for all instances of this class. And because the handle to the partition that we're referencing is going to be different for each instance, unless we already we're all using the same one, but let's assume we're not, we also need to pass the static method, the handle that we want to talk to. So we're going to pass in a MVS handle type and call it handle. Because this is static, we don't have access to the member variable handle because this is not static, so it'll be different for each instance, so it has to be passed in like that. And then we need the key and the output. Okay, cool, that's good. Right. Now we need to do some thinking. We can do, first of all, a bit of error checking here. So, first thing we need to check is the key. So we'll do if null pointer equals equals key. Then we can return ESP error invalid arg because that makes sense. If the key is a null pointer, well, that makes no sense because it has to be an ASCII string. What else could go wrong here? Well, or if the string length of key is zero. So we've just tried to pass in where key equals that. Key would not be a null pointer, but the string is empty, Again, you can't have a key that is empty. It has to have some sort of stuff in it, like that. And again, if you're familiar with Python, it would be like trying to put none as the key. Now we've used string len here, so that means we need to include C string. Almost string, like that. Lovely. And then that gives us string len. So if we pass in a null pointer or we pass in an empty string, then the argument's invalid. So we can just return straight away. Else, what are we going to Right. And this is where it gets messy in the API. In the API, there are various different getters where there's a get unsigned int 8, there's get signed int 8, there's get, like we showed, would be really, really bad to do. Now they've done it that way because it's written in C, so they don't have C++ templates to assist them. But the problem is here, we would then have to do, I don't know, some sort of switch on T, and then so let's sort of do some pseudocode here. Case uint 8 return nvs get uint 8 and call that function from the API, or whoops, and then like one for int, one for 16s for signed, one for 32s, and you can see where this is starting to become rather unmaintainable. Where that would be 32, that would be 16, that would be 16, that would be int, that would be int. For example, dot dot dot. That's starting to get a bit messy. We're also doing a switch on a type name, which I'm not even certain you can do. Probably not, actually. I'm not sure. I've never tried to do it. It just wouldn't be a good way of doing it. But what the API does provide us, and we've already got an inkling of what it might be, is we can get a buffer. So we can just get a chunk of memory. That is our friend in this case, because we can be clever here. And that this is, I like the way I've done this, actually, not trying to blow my own trumpet too much. But what we can do is get the size of the type. By doing size of t, and we know that at compile time. So if we try to get an int, then size of int is 4. If we're doing a char, size of char is 1, 8 bits, 1 byte, so size of is 1. So now we actually know how much memory each of these types requires. We know this at compile time, which is really, really good. So we can use the get buffer thing here. Okay, so let's roll with that idea. So that means we are going to return, oh gosh, our get buffer method function. It's going to be static, so function. And we're going to need to pass that the handle, the key, and the output, and this number of bytes because we're going to be getting a buffer. Now, that won't work on its own because we're passing in, say, a char, but a buffer, we already know. Requires a pointer from that. So we need to take the address of this variable. So we do that. So now we're passing it in by pointer, and we're saying how many bytes we want to read. Okay. We still need to implement this function. Let's not worry about it. Let's follow this through in the top down way of doing things. So we need to do the same again for set. And this is inadvertently becoming a header only implementation. Which actually it's going to have to be a header only implementation, I think, because of the way we're doing the templates. That's wrong. There we go. Yeah, there we go. Have I done that? Yeah, that's why we're getting red. Awesome. So our setter, whoop, is largely going to do the same thing. So we can actually copy and paste that down to start with. We still need to check if the key is valid, so we can leave that in. And then what we need to do is return set buff for that. However, remember we need to check whether or not what we wrote to the MVS is there. So we now need to do a get to make sure that when we get the data in the non-volatile, it is actually what we set it to, because we can't just fire and forget and take it for granted. We want to verify. So we also need to do a verify. Now, the way the API works is it actually has its own chunk of RAM. So when you do a write, it actually saves it in the non-volatile's RAM, and then periodically it will then actually write that those ones and noughts to the flash. It doesn't do that when you just set stuff. It's a way of basically speeding the whole thing up, because flash read and writes are slow. So if you can have a copy in RAM, then you can access them a lot quicker. It's a way of getting around the fact that these are key value pairs, and speeding things up. So we also need to do a verify, and return that. So we could be horrible and do... No, that wouldn't work. Ord with a verify. And we want to verify for a handle, a key, an output, and a number of bytes. So if this returns ESP OK, then we OR ESP OK, which is 0, with the verify. And if this returns ESP OK, we're ORing 0 with 0, so we return 0, which is ESP OK. If either one of these fails, so say this one fails, returns 1, so ESP fail, we then try and verify it, that's also going to return 1, for example. So we're ORing 1 with 1, so it's still 1, so it would return ESP fail. That's a bit horrible notation. The other way of doing it is we could just do this as another if. So we could do ESP OK equals equals that. Then we will return verify. Else return ESP fail. The way that's a bit... actually, no, that this would probably be better. But it would make more sense to actually have a status. So we want to return what set buffer is. So we need a variable here, don't we? So we can do a const ES. Status, and then we can call set buffer. Oops. Oh dear. Status. So we set the buffer. If ESP OK is status, then we'll return verify. Otherwise, we can return status here. There we go, that probably makes a bit more sense. And then we're actually cascading down what the error was, if an error occurred. Okay, that's good. These are static and they're going to be private, so we'll give them the underscores. There we are, lovely. So the way we force the API to write what we've set, so it's currently storing it in RAM and it'll write it when it decides it wants to write it, we have to force it to do that, like calling a flush, for example, if you're familiar with C in and C out and that side of things. So actually we need to force a flush here. And that is done by an API call, nvs commit, and we're going to pass in the handle. Now this could fail. In fact, is it going to tell me that if I hover over? Yes. So we need to actually have this in our if chain. So now we actually want to do. What am I doing? We want to do that, and then if ESP OK is state. This is getting messy. All right, we can write this in a slightly nicer way. First of all, this shouldn't be state. This shouldn't be const. So we set the buffer. And then we can do if ESP OK equals equals status, then we can do status or equals that. And that effectively achieves the same thing. And if that is OK, then we'll verify. And then we'll just return status. So if any one of these fails, the first one to fail, it will stop all the other ones being called and it will just return the status. So that looks a bit cleaner than having huge nested ifs. So there we go, lovely. So we've almost got down to the level of of the API calls, but we still need to implement set buffer and verify. Let's do verify first. So again, it's going to be a template. Oh dear. Type name T. And don't worry, we're nearly actually done here. Let me just, yeah, we're not far off. This is becoming a longer episode than I planned, but never mind. You know what, we'll stop after verify and we'll leave the next one for buffers. So again, this is going to be no discard, because why would you verify and not care about the result? It's going to be static. It's going to return an error type. We'll precede it with an underscore, just because that's the notation I like. And then we'll do that. And oh, I've just noticed on the set, so this is going to be the input. Not an output, is it? So let's just change that so that reads a bit nicer. Yeah, lovely. Cool. And this will be the input as well. Okay, good. So to do our verify, what do we need to do? Well, first of all, we need to get the value from non-volatile. So we know how to do that. We don't need the setter, so let's collapse that. We've got a method to do that for us. So to get that, we can just pass it the handle, we can pass it the key, and we can pass it the input. No, we can't. We can't pass it the input because this is a getter, so it's the output. So we need to pass it a new variable of type t. And we can do that. That we're going to call the value in the non-volatile. And then we can pass that in. So now the get will get the value on the handle for this key and save it to this type name T. Now this is where templates get clever and this becomes much more maintainable because if we change something in here, we don't then need to change it for every single different type that we've implemented. But this could fail. So let's do our usual thing like that. And then we need to check whether or not this was okay. And in fact, yes. So if, and you're going to see this a lot. Status, then we want to do so. Now we have the value the user thinks it is, the value that we've just read. So if the two are the same, then everything's good. So if input equals equals val in NVS, then we can return ESP else we can return ESP fail. And if the getter didn't work, we can just return status, so whatever the error was there. So we declare a new variable of type T. We get the variable stored at that key. If the get was successful, compare it to what the user thinks it is. If it's the same, then all is good. Else, it failed. And if the getter failed, then return whatever the error was that the getter provided. So I'm a bit hesitant because the reason it's in my notes, I've done this the wrong way around. I put ESP fail there, which of course is incorrect. So that's our verify. And the verify actually, oh, it doesn't quite go all the way down to the API yet. So, what have we got left to do in the next episode? We need to define our get buff, which we're going to use. We need to define our set buff. We're going to need a verify buff. because at the moment this will only verify a type. It won't verify an entire array, for example. And I think that is more or less it. Yeah, that's all we need to do. So we've got three more to do. You can have a think about that in your own time if you wish. In the meantime, I'll try and fix why menu config isn't working. So in the next episode, I can show you the last thing you need to do for the petition table. We'll get these functions written, and then we'll give it a test at the low level, just doing some debug output and make sure it all works. As usual, questions, comments, and so on down below. And I hope you enjoyed. See you in the next one.